Just brief reminder what was our initial consideration. After a brief revision of certain background in geometry, we used the main definition of Klein geometry, saying what geometry is the theory of invariance in for certain transitive action of a group of symmetries. And we want to discover all possible geometries which may be derived from the group SL2R, which is a group of 2×2 matrices with real entries and determinant equal to 1. We will use the technique of Lie group, and for Lie group, the main addition to the usual group theory is existence of certain smooth structure which allow to introduce operation of differentiation, infinitesimal generators of certain one parameter continuous subgroups. And the connection between this generators and one parameter subgroup is given by exponentiation. So if we have a generator X, when exponentiating it with a parameter, real parameter T, we get one parameter subgroup, continuous subgroup of the given Lie group. And for the Lie algebra, the main operation besides of linear structure is a commutator between two elements. Again, this is a part of some general big theory, but in our particular case, element of the group are 2×2 matrices with determinant equal to 1. Elements of the Lie, corresponding Lie algebras are 2×2 real matrices with the trace equal to 0. And all these operation, linear operation or commutators, are just performed in the usual sense of matrix multiplication, matrix addition. So usual rules are applied, so we can use certain direct calculation to verify certain properties. Now, if we are looking for a transitive action of the group of SL2R, it will be good to discuss first the technique which connect groups and their action on certain spaces. So again, this is like a common feature for the all groups which are maybe considered in certain abstract sense, and corresponding image of this group as being the transformation of a set. So typically, we will consider a group G acting on certain set X by transformation. So we will write what element G map an element of a set X to a set G dot X, where G in our group and X is element of this set. So something like we have X, the set X, and G transform elements X to G X on this set. And one of the example which is related to SL2R will be just to give an illustration how it's work. So let X be the real line, and transformation which we are taking is the affine transformation, which consists of scaling and shifts. So that is A and B, two parameters, we just describe them now, and point X, which is a real number, is transformed to a real number AX plus B. And A here, the scaling parameter, so it's positive real number. So R plus, meaning A is positive, and B just a real number, arbitrary real number. So such a transformation on real numbers is 1-to-1, so it's invertible. The identity element obviously given by 1, 0, so zero shift is scaling with parameter 1. It sends any X to itself, So this is identity element. And the inverse also can be calculated. So this is really the group, and it's became Lie group if we will consider natural topology here, just inherited from topology of corresponding parameters. So actually, what is also worth to think about, and again, it's relevant to what we are discussing. So it's worth to consider that affine group. So it's group affine transformation. So maybe denote it like that. B being horizontal axis on this picture, any real number. And A is a positive real number. So affine group actually represented by points in the open upper half plane. So all these points, so this is AB, points which represent element of the affine group. And here the topology just inherited from the topology of the plane, Euclidean topology, will be a topology on our group. So this is one simple example how a group may act on certain space. We will see much more examples, interesting examples soon. But let us discuss property of transitivity. So we may introduce, if we will have such an action of a group on certain space X, then we may introduce an equivalence relation saying what two elements on a set are equivalent if there is a group of transformation, there is element from the group of transformation which map one element into another. So then easier to check what it's indeed an equivalence relation. So by the standard mathematical procedure, equivalence relation introduce the collection of cosets. In this particular case, these cosets called orbits. So actually we may think about collection points in the same cosets as being just an orbit of one point X under all possible transformations. So if X can be moved to any point here, our action became transitive. And in fact, any set X can be represented as a disjoint union of corresponding orbits. So we simply, it's easy to verify what no two orbits may have a common point, and every point of a set X belong to at least one or exactly to one orbit, not at least, exactly to one orbit. So any action of the group can be splitted into transitive action on corresponding orbits. And from now on, we will be, for this reason, we'll be just interested to investigate, to look on such transitive actions on the orbits. Here there is two directional connection between these transitive actions and subgroups. So by the way, if group G act on a set X in transitive way, we will just say what this set X form a homogeneous space. So homogeneous space means what action of symmetry on this space is transitive. And so easy to verify what for any point X, if we will consider collection of all elements which fixed this point, so G of X, it will be a subgroup of a G. So it's called isotropy subgroup of point X. And then here we may just place a couple of easy exercises which you may try to solve yourself, practice with it, is as follow with exercises. So for a homogeneous space X, And any two points x1, x2 in x, the isotropy subgroups gx1 and gx2 are conjugate. They are conjugate in the sense of the following operation. So element g send a point x to the product gx g inverse. Of course, such an expression for a commutative group will be trivial, just cancellation occur. But for non-commutative groups, which are appearing in our situation, that is non-trivial action. So a conjugate, that means where I exist, element g in g such that gx1 is equal g times gx2 g inverse. So if we have two isotropy subgroup, they are conjugated. So, and in this sense, it doesn't matter which point, fixed point you are considering, as all isotropy subgroups are conjugated, and this is a kind of equivalence relation conjugation for subgroup, which we are deemed to be trivial. It doesn't matter which point you are taking out, so for this isotropy subgroup, result will be equivalent. One of the standard way to introduce homogeneous spaces or an action of a group on a sum set, this is action of a group on itself. So we consider the case where set X is group itself, and then there is that action of conjugation, which we already discussed. So any group act on itself by this formula. And there are also two other actions, like a halves of conjugation. This is the left shift, where we multiply by element of the group from the left, and right shift, where we multiply by the corresponding element from the right. So here is minus one appears because we want with be the group homomorphism from the G to the group of transformation of the set X, which is a G. So that conjugation left and right shift will repeatedly appear in our course. So this is a kind of universal important operations which are of interest for us. So in previous slide we have seen how a homogeneous space create particular subgroup, isotropy subgroup of some particular point on the homogeneous space. And we may proceed just in opposite direction. We may pick up any group, subgroup of a group G, and construct the corresponding homogeneous space, space where our group G act by transitive transformations. So discussion is as follows. So we have a group G and we pick up any subgroup H. So if H will be a normal subgroup of G, then the following set G cosets G slash H will be just having a group structure for normal subgroup. Here we don't make such an assumption. In our consideration, H not necessarily normal, and most oftenly is not normal in our consideration. So we introduce the following equivalence relation between elements of the group G. We say what they are equivalent if there is certain element from our subgroup H such that G1 is equal to G2 times this H. Again, an easy exercise is to check what this is indeed an equivalence relation on the group G. So all three properties, reflexivity, symmetry, and transitivity can be verified using condition for G being the corresponding group, having a group structure. And then we may consider that collection of cosets as the homogeneous space with respect to corresponding left shifts. So we multiply by element G from the left. Again, it's an easy exercise to verify what left shift respect our equivalence relation. So again, it's not a difficult exercise. Just to check if G1 is equivalent G2, so in the sense of this subgroup H in G, then for any G in G, G G1 will be equivalent to G G2. So that left action preserves equivalence classes. And so we may factor out transformation left shifts to its action not on the group G, but rather on the collection of these equivalence classes. It's not very convenient to work with equivalence classes because this is large sets. And it's very standard technique. What we want to introduce certain parametrization for these equivalence classes. So it's like we pick up a representative for each equivalence class, just one representative. Well, saying maybe in some common terms, if you have equivalence class to be a country, you are selecting the president, someone who will represent that country outside for all other purposes. So we are choosing a certain element from the group G which represent corresponding equivalence classes. Typically, so that map, commonly in mathematics known as a section, because it's a kind of inverse, just right inverse to the projection. So that section typically needs to have some additional condition. It may be required to be continuous or measurable if we have certain measure on our group or some other condition. So depending from the our purposes, we may put that corresponding restriction. So name section may be again clarified by such a picture. So we have a group G which has split it into some equivalence classes, and it's happened what points from the same equivalence classes, so some points appear in an equivalence class. So we are looking for a section S which pick up one representative, so something like that. So we have one representative for each equivalence class. So collection of equivalence classes pick up a representative between equivalent elements. Equivalent elements are on the same vertical line. So so this is a section S which we are discussing here. And that map from the group G to corresponding equivalence classes is typically well, called natural projection, when we assign to an element the equivalence class which contain this element. So this is a right inverse this is our requirement, what it will be right inverse when we are taking that section. And it's because this is right inverse to many to one map, of course it will not be the left inverse, but it restore, if we will apply it from the left to P, as it's restore our initial element just with an error within the subgroup H. So this is like another exercise. You may verify highlighted formula. What left action of S on P restore G up to an element in the subgroup H. And then we may introduced the last map which needed here, and actually that map R will be needed in the second part of our course, which related to representation of the group SL to R. This is the map which just indicate that portion H from subgroup H, which is a kind of residue, which we have a difference between left inverse and true inverse of map P. So this is the last condition which introduces that residue. At our geometrical consideration, first part of the course, we will not use that map, but it will be required later. So let us look what it follows, the general consideration for our case particular. That consideration which was before is rather general. It's for generic group G and homogeneous spaces, but what it imply for consideration of our SL to R case. So for SL to R, I will recall just what we have two way connections. We have homogeneous space, and then from any homogeneous space we define some isotropy subgroup. Or having subgroup, we may define corresponding homogeneous space. So that is two-way connection between this element of the group theory. And in order to apply it to SL2R and study transitive action of SL2R, we need to classify all possible subgroups of SL2R. If we will take a subgroup of SL2R, then construct corresponding homogeneous space G over H, when we can study geometry of this homogeneous space. For, again, purpose of this course, we will work only with continuous subgroup of SL2R. Subgroups which are not continuous, which are discrete, they are, again, important and very interesting, but will not be considered, so it's kind of a different theory. It's a lot of number theory and properties of integers which will play the role if we will consider discrete subgroups. So just to stay on analytical side of our consideration, we will work with continuous subgroup. And if we are working with continuous subgroup and we want to have certain preservation of the structures, analytical structure, continuous structure of the group G, then we need to place an additional condition. So if G is a Lie group, and H is a closed, topologically closed subgroup . Then again, it's maybe kind of exercise, maybe not very elementary one, but it's possible to do using rather standard result from topology. The homogeneous space G over H is a topological space. So staying on that analytical part of our consideration, we always assume what our subgroup H is continuous and topologically closed within the subgroup SL2R. So SL2R, as I already told, is three-dimensional. Analytically, it's three-dimensional in the sense what we have four parameters and one restrictions. So continuous one-parameter subgroup also will be Lie group. So it's meaningful to speak about their dimensionality. And if it's not a trivial subgroup, which is entire SL2R, and if it's not the identity, then only possible dimensions for continuous subgroup will be 2 and 1. And it's again a bit of algebra to verify that the two-dimensional subgroup of SL2R are given by triangular matrices, upper or lower triangular matrices. And here we have this collection subgroup F, which presented by lower and upper triangular matrices. Again, here A is positive real, and B and C just a real numbers. And it's easy again to see what these two subgroups are conjugated. So I think if you will try to make a conjugation with the matrix 0, 1, minus 1, 0 from the subgroup SL2R, so it's matrix with the unit determinant, and its inverse 0, minus 1, 1, 0, so you will find what this is exactly subgroup F prime. Just again another useful remark. Just to reduce the amount of logical possibilities which we shall consider. If subgroup H1 and H2 of G are conjugated, then the corresponding homogeneous spaces G over H1 are isomorphic as G spaces, spaces where our group act by transitive transformation. So if you have two conjugated subgroups, then it's just enough to consider one of them as element for this construction of homogeneous space. The second one will produce the equivalent result, so there is no need to study another one. And that suggests what we just need to take one of subgroup F and F prime. Another useful remark, what F is isomorphic to the group of affine transformation of the real line, as we have discussed before, to the group affine transformation. And isomorphism is given as follow: element AB of the affine group may be mapped to the matrix 1 over square root of A. AB 1. 0. So this is the map. And then just a direct calculation shows what the same group law which we have on the affine group is given by the matrix multiplication by of these 2 times 2 matrices with 2 parameters. So that is an isomorphism, so we have here that affine group, also known as AX plus B group, just due to the action which we have discussed before. So this is about two-dimensional subgroups. What about one-dimensional continuous subgroups of SL2R? We may spot just by trial several examples of such one-parameter subgroup. So this is the group of diagonal matrices with determinant 1. So here I produce corresponding elements from the Lie algebra. So this is exponentiation of a matrix with the trace 0, which produce that one-parameter subgroup. There is again upper triangular subgroup with one-parameter T here. And there is a subgroup which we already discussed. This is the compact subgroup, maximal compact subgroup of SL2R, consisting of matrices cosine T, sine T, minus sine T, and cosine T, which is exponentiation of this matrix 0, T, minus T, 0. And here parameter T, just due to periodicity of trigonometric function, can be taken from interval from minus pi to pi. So this is examples of one-parameter subgroups. You may again verify subgroup property just multiplying two such matrices and seeing what the result of multiplication is exactly the matrix of the same type with parameter T plus S. And important result for us would be what any one-parameter continuous subgroup of SL2R shall be conjugated either to A, N, or K. So essentially up to conjugation, and as we discussed in that previous remark, no need to consider conjugated subgroup as different. So up to a conjugation, no other result are possible. And this again can be proven by the elementary calculations. So any one-parameter subgroup, as we said before, is obtained by exponentiation of its generator, generator from the Lie algebra. And generator would be 2 times 2 matrix with 0 trace. And so we need to just analyze what type of generators we may have. And that is also a rather elementary result about matrices. Matrix 2 times 2 matrix with 0 trace shall contain A and minus A on the main diagonal. And then if you multiply such matrix to itself, you will find out what this is identity matrix times the A square plus BC, which is minus determinant of matrix X. So whatever X is, its square is always identity matrix with this number. And actually, it's easy to demonstrate that any matrices with the corresponding sign of determinant. So essentially, we have here the most important parameter, which is the sign of this determinant of X. So if determinant is positive, that is means minus determinant X is less than 0, we obtain in the exponentiation the subgroup K. If we get result equal to 0, then our X shall be conjugated to the generator of subgroup N. And if determinant of X is negative, so minus determinant is bigger than 0, then that generator is equivalent by conjugation to the generator of subgroup A. So essentially, we at this point meet the situation what x square is equal either plus identity, zero, or minus identity. So this is what happened with generators of from the Lie algebra SL to R, and that be the source of hypercomplex units which are continuously appear in our course. So we will see three types of hypercomplex units which will be useful to describe corresponding geometry. Just to remind you why this is important, that behavior of the x square, just coming back, so coming back to this Taylor expansion, so we have here the all powers of x generator x. So we have x1 plus x square with some coefficient, but x square is already identity with certain sign plus, minus, or zero. Then x cube, but this is x square times x, and x square is identity, so x cube is the same as x. Then x4, which is square of x square, and x square is identity, and so on, so on. So actually, we have split here into just even and odd powers. Even powers are multiples of x, and odd powers are multiples of x, and even powers here of x will be a multiple of identity. So that greatly simplify that Taylor expansion for SL to R, and we have just three types different behavior depending from the sign. Actually, one more element which need to be described, when we are classifying subgroups, we also do it not only up to conjugation, but also up to a rescaling. What does it mean? It's just an observation. What as a subgroup of H, if it's represented as e to the power tx for some x in the corresponding Lie algebra, it's exactly the same as collection of e t a times x with the same condition for all a bigger than zero, real number a bigger than zero. So as I said, scaling of x produce the same result because t is any real number, so multiplication by a does not change the behavior of our subgroup. So in this particular case, when we have just three situation with the sign of generator x, we always can scale that generator x by by positive real parameter a to be the determinant such what square is exactly identity matrix or minus identity matrix or zero. So we may obtain that free situation. And then if we have corresponding subgroups, we may describe the respective action of SL2R on the homogeneous spaces. So just recall how we introduce equivalence relation between element of the group. This is elements are equivalent if there is H from the subgroup, what we have a difference in this element from the subgroup. When there is natural projection from the group to equivalence classes, to cosets, which assign to an element of the group corresponding cosets, which contain that element. And we choose a certain section, which is right inverse to this natural projection. And then action is obtained from the left shifts. So it's given as follow. We have that map S, which put homogeneous space from homogeneous space to the group. When we multiply on the left by element of the group, and then we apply the natural projection and come back to the homogeneous space. In this way, if I just consider the lower two lower edges of this diagram, I get an action of a group from homogeneous space to homogeneous space. So let us apply this construction to the case where our matrix, where our subgroup H consists of lower triangular matrices. This is a group, two-dimensional subgroup, which we identify with the affine group. So just a reminder where we get it. So we have this subgroup F, and we are doing corresponding calculations. So natural projection here may be parameterized by B divided by D. So that is the unique representative for every coset, and respective section from and again corresponding homogeneous space will be one-dimensional, because we have three-dimensional group SL to R. We factorize by two-dimensional subgroup F, so homogeneous space will be one-dimensional. And it's represented just by one real number, B divided by D. So section will be given by the map to the upper triangular matrices. And again, it's easy to verify what it's right inverse. If I map U to such upper triangular matrix, then map P put it back to the U again. And then composition of the map according to the diagram, where we first put S, then left action of the G, and then the corresponding element natural projection, will produce the following important linear fractional transformation, or so-called Möbius transformation of a real number, or Möbius transformation of the real line. So interesting consequence of this transformation is if you will put upper triangular matrix AB 0, 1, we will just recover the affine action of AX plus B group. So if A, B are preserved, C is 0, D is 1, so upper triangular matrices act as the affine group in that transformation. So this is how transformation of the real line appears in the homogeneous spaces of SL to R. As I already advertised, certain part of the theory will be given in additional videos, and probably I will record one of the videos which I will record, will be how this Möbius transformation on the real line appears from the projective geometry point of view, how we get them in terms of projective real line. So it will not be a long video, maybe 10 minutes, but it's interesting to add as an extra point of view on this important transformation of the real line. So this is just a simple calculation, so straightforward substitution of general construction into that particular case. What happened if we have here the subgroup H to be one-dimensional? So again, as we discussed before, it's enough to consider just representatives up to equivalence condition, conjugation condition, it's A, N, or K here. So we may just take any of this. And it's again one of the main points of in our course, what we may treat them simultaneously, all three cases, if we will adjust our mathematics accordingly. So let H be one of this group, A and K, and we again just use the previous diagram to generate action on corresponding homogeneous space. This time homogeneous space shall be two-dimensional. We have three-dimensional group factored by one-dimensional subgroup, so homogeneous space is two-dimensional. And as a section for all three cases, A and the K, we choose the same map S, here, again map a pair of real numbers U and V, with V being positive, to the upper triangular matrices. Again, you may see it's somehow similar to the matrices from the subgroup F dash on the this slide. So that is there is some relation here to this map. Then again, we use this composition of maps and calculate the result. So calculation in this case a bit laborious, and answer, if you look on the form with the real parameters, two real parameters U and V, is not a simple one. So this is such a long formula. We see what we have two components, and some simplification come here from or unification of three cases. Remember, we are dealing with three different cases, A and K. Here, a difference between these cases is encoded into parameter sigma. So sigma here is equal minus one for subgroup K, it's equal zero for subgroup N, and it's equal to one for subgroup A. So result come out the same up to this parameter sigma here. And we may get a very nice attractive formula for this expression if we will introduce hypercomplex corresponding numbers. So we combine U and V into one number using hypercomplex unit iota, such what its square, exactly the same parameter sigma, which was before, is equal minus 101 for corresponding subgroup A and K. So when this formula, again, it's some algebra, just algebra to verify, give that nice compact expression, which is actually almost identical with the previous case of subgroup subgroup F. So the, from previous slides, I remind you what we have with action on reals. Now we have just the same action on corresponding hypercomplex numbers. So probably it's time to stop lecture today, and we will discuss consequences of our discovery of that unified linear fractional transformation with three type or four type of numbers, if you include real numbers, on the next lecture. Any questions?